So welcome to the first tutorial on the combined units, unit 2 and unit 3. That is all about the small signal amplifier. So as you know, as far as our syllabus is concerned, in unit 2 we have the DC biasing circuit, the bias stability, the different types of biasing circuits like a fixed bias, collector to base bias, voltage divider bias and all. And in unit 3 we have the small signal behavior of the transistor amplifier, the calculation of the gain, the different types of gains like the voltage gain, current gain, transconductance gain, transresistance gain. So a lot of things are there in this unit 3 particularly. And as far as the configuration of any transistor is concerned, amplifier is concerned, we have three types of configuration for this BJT amplifier. One is known as the common emitter configuration. Second one is common base. Third one is common collector. So we'll be discussing this common base and common collector amplifier gradually. And today I would like to confine my discussion on tutorial one, particularly with the concept of common emitter amplifier model. So let me start with our first problem today. I would rather say it's a warm-up problem to start with. So it is told that no model has been given, no circuit has been given. The question says that a particular amplifier design application requires GM, that is a mutual transconductance, that value, GM value is equal to 80 milliampere per volt, and the RPi value, that is the resistance between base to emitter, that is equal to 1.2 kilo ohms. So you need to find out the value. So given these two, these are the two design requirements, and based on this you have to find out the value of ICQ, the quiescent collector current, and the value of beta, that is the current gain, common emitter current gain. So to start with, let me just tell you what do you mean by this, all these terms like GM, RPi, beta and all. So as you know, we have a transistor like this. So let's start with an NPN transistor, which is having three different terminals. So as you know, this is known as the base terminal. This is the collector terminal, and you have this emitter terminal. So base, collector and emitter. So it's a three terminal device. Now, for the clarity of our discussion, we would prefer to observe this transistor as a two-port network. And in connection to that, one of the terminals is considered to be common, and the input is applied at the other terminal, and the output is obtained from the third terminal. So for example, if I consider the emitter terminal is common to both the input and the output, then that particular configuration is known as common emitter configuration. And then the input is applied at the base, and we are taking the output at the collector terminal. So then the base emitter terminal will be treated as the input terminal or input port, and the collector emitter terminal is known as the output port. So what we are doing is we are visualizing the transistor amplifier, BJT amplifier, as a two-port network, just like this, as a two-port network. But now, as you know, the transistor is having three terminals, base, collector and emitter. So how to fit this one into this two-port network? Because you have first one, two, three, four different terminals. So one terminal has to be common. So if I consider that the emitter terminal is common, then it is known as a common emitter configuration. If the base terminal is common, then it is known as a common base configuration. And if the collector terminal is common, then it is known as a common collector configuration. Now today, our all the discussions will be restricted to common emitter configuration only. That means the input is applied between the base and emitter, and the output is obtained between the collector and emitter terminal. So now, whenever we are trying to observe the behavior of this particular device, then what you already mentioned, that as far as the pi model is concerned, so there are different types of model. We have pi model, we have z parameter model, and h parameter model. So there are lots of models. Now, as far as the pi model is concerned, in pi model, the small signal equivalent circuit of the device looks something like that. So if I consider, okay, so let me mark this as my base terminal. This is, let this be the emitter terminal. This be the collector. Once again, this is the emitter terminal. So what we find is between base to emitter, we have one resistance, which we refer like R pi. And between collector to emitter, we have one current source whose value is given by, I can write it over here. That value is given by Gm times V pi, where V pi is this voltage across the resistance R pi, that is the V pi. And we have another resistance, which is known as R naught. So these are the three different parameters: R pi connected between the base to emitter, the resistance, and the voltage across this R pi is known as V pi. And the between collector to emitter, we have one voltage dependent current source that is known as Gm times V pi. And we have another resistance connected between collector and emitter, which is known as R naught. And obviously these two terminals are connected together because both of them are emitter terminal. Now, the value of these parameters, as you know, R pi, Gm, and R naught. So they are basically dependent upon the DC characteristics of the transistor itself. That means the current flowing through the transistor under the DC condition. For example, what is R pi? R pi is not known as the input resistance. That means the variation of the input. If I consider here, so here my input voltage is VBE. And if I consider the input current, so VB is the input voltage, and input current is IB, the base current. So the variation of this input voltage with respect to this input current is known as the input resistance. So R pi is basically written like formally delta VBE upon delta IB. And in fact, as you know, between base to emitter, the transistor is basically working as a diode. So you have PN junction diode. So if I consider this is my base emitter voltage and this be my base current, then obviously the nature looks something like that. It's a PN junction diode, so diode characteristics in the forward biased. So how to find out the resistance? So as you know, you have a slope like this, and the slope is not constant because, as you know, this particular function is an exponential function. So we can write this current I as a function of VB, like IB is equal to the small signal current, can be written as I is by beta e to the power VB by VT minus 1. So therefore, as you know, as you can observe from this particular expression also, the slope of this particular graph is not constant. And the inverse of the slope is nothing but the resistance R pi, 1 upon delta IB by delta VB, that is equal to R pi. So the slope is not constant. But however, if I consider that the variation of the input signal with respect to some DC points, if I consider that this is my DC biasing point, let me consider this is my DC biasing point. So accordingly here, you have the corresponding base current and corresponding base emitter voltage. So let me call this to be say IBQ, and this be VBQ. Now, over and above this VBQ, obviously there will be certain small signal which is superimposed with this VBQ. Then ultimately, this one, VBE, that is the total instantaneous voltage, can be written as VBQ, the DC component, plus the small signal component, that is small VB. If I assume that that variation is small with respect to this VBQ, then that particular slope can be considered to be almost constant, and you can compute this slope at the point of VBQ, IBQ. And if you do the mathematical calculation, then you will find that this R pi can be obtained as Vt, thermal voltage, divided by IBQ. So R pi basically gives you the variation of the input voltage with respect to the input current. Similarly, you have this R naught, which is known as the variation of the output voltage with respect to the output current. So normally, as you know, in the expression, if you just forget about the early effect, then you find that the collector current, if you just write down the expression for the collector current here, you'll find that this collector current can be represented as IC is equal to some IS into e to the power VB by VT minus 1. Or if you just neglect this minus 1 term, then simply e to the power VB by VT, because that if that value VB by VT is pretty large with respect to 1. So e to the power of that is much, much larger as compared to 1. So you can safely just ignore this 1. So normally you find that the value of this collector current IC depends only on the input voltage, that is the VBE. And if you want to compute the variation of this collector current with respect to the input voltage, then you get another parameter, which is known as the mutual transconductance. So since it is transconductance, so it is delta IC upon delta VBE. So what is the physical significance of that? That means, as you know, the expression for the IC is given by the collector current IS into e to the power VB by VT. Or you can, if you want, you can also consider this minus one as well. So here also I need to put this bracket. So in fact, that value is much, much larger with respect to one. So therefore, you can approximate this one to be so IC can be approximated to be IS d to the power VB by VT. Here you find that the collector current depends only on the base emitter voltage. So the variation of this collector current with respect to the base emitter voltage is known as the transconductance or mutual conductance. Why mutual? Because one parameter is at the input terminal, the other parameter is taken at the output terminal. This IC is taken as at the output terminal and VB is taken at the input terminal. So that's why it is known as the mutual conductance or transconductance. And if you do the same calculation, here you find that the expression for GM is given by ICQ by VT. So once again, you have to compute this GM at the DC biasing point. And if you just want to incorporate the concept of the early effect, then you know that the value of IC, the collector current, doesn't depend only on VB, but it also depends upon the collector to emitter voltage. And then the considering the early effect, now if you just take into consideration the impact of early effect, then this collector current IC can be written as IS into e to the power VB by VT minus 1 multiplied with 1 plus VCE by VA, where VA is known as early voltage. So here you find, if you consider the early effect into your consideration, then the collector current also depends upon VCE. And if you compute this one, the variation of this collector current with respect to VCE, or 1 upon that, that means if you want to calculate this one, 1 upon delta IC by delta VC, then at the DC operating point, that is coming as approximately, obviously, it is approximately obtained as VA upon ICQ, where VA is known as the early voltage. So normally the value of the early voltage is very large, few hundreds of volt. So that's why the value of R naught is pretty large. So since R naught is large with respect to the load resistance or the collector resistance, so in many of the cases you can safely ignore R naught. But if the value of VA early voltage is given in the problem, then obviously you have to take into account the value of R naught, and accordingly you have to do your calculation. So ultimately, we do have those three parameters in the pi model. One is known as the R pi, the input resistance. Second one is known as the GM, that is the mutual transconductance. And the third one is known as the R naught, that is the output resistance. Now, coming back to our problem, it was given that GM is equal to 80 milliampere per volt and R pi is equal to 1.2 kilo ohms. So you have to find out IC2 and beta. So it's very simple to find it out. Once again, I have to write down the values which are provided already. That is 80 milliampere per volt. And the value of R pi is equal to 1.2 kilo ohms. Now, another thing you can notice from this expression, from these two expressions, that if you multiply GM and R pi, what you find is GM multiplied with R pi is given by ICQ upon VT multiplied with VT upon IPQ. So this is nothing but ICQ upon IPQ, which is nothing but the current gain, the DC current gain, that is beta. So GM into R pi is equal to beta. So that is another important observation. If GM and R pi is given to you, so you can directly compute the value of beta to be the product of GM and R pi. So you have 80 milliampere per volt multiplied with 1.2. So what you find is 18 to 1.2 will give you 96. And it is unitless because you have milliampere per volt multiplied with kilo ohms. So it is unitless. So the gain, the corresponding current gain of the transistor is given by 96 ohms. And another thing you have to find it out, what is known as the ICQ, that means the DC collector current. So how to find it out? So it can be obtained directly from the value of GM only, because as you know, GM is equal to ICQ upon VT. So from this, all you need to know is the value of VT, the thermal voltage. And if nothing is specified, the thermal voltage at the room temperature of 300 Kelvin is obtained as 25 millivolt or 26 millivolt. So considering VT to be equal to say 25 millivolt or 26 millivolt, say let it be 25.5, so 26 millivolt. So you can easily find it out the value for ICQ. So here it is 80, GM is equal to 80, that is equal to ICQ upon VT. ICQ upon VT, VT is 26. Millivolt. So it will be better if I want to represent it in volt, because already 80 is there in unit of milliampere per volt. So let me represent this one in volt only, that is 0.026. So from that, what you can deduce is ICQ is equal to, so milliampere per volt, that is the unit of GM multiplied with this much of volt. So ultimately the resultant value will be milliampere only. So 80 multiplied with 0.026 will give you 2.08 milliampere. So this is all about the problem and the corresponding solution that you have to find it out here. So it has nothing to do with the circuit topology. It has nothing to do with the analysis of the small signal model. Only you have to find out the corresponding parameters of the small signal model of the transistor so that you can proceed further. Now, with this basic understanding, let us now move to our first problem. Theoretically, it will be the second problem, but technically speaking, it will be the first problem on this particular tutorial. Given a circuit like this, a simple biasing topology. I'm just showing it now. So the base is biased separately with a different battery source, and you have a different supply here. This is VCC that is given like 5 volt. You have some RC, the collector resistance, that is given as 4 kilo ohm. And this one is the input signal that we are going to amplify, that is VS. And you have this one, the battery, to bias the base emitter junction. And this value is VB, that is equal to 2 volt. And we have one base resistance here, RB, that is equal to 250 kilo ohms. So you're applying the input. First of all, you have to observe that you have to bias the transistor. So that's why this 2 volt supply has been provided. Otherwise, what you can do is you can also take in the supply from this particular end, and you can use a voltage divider bias to bias this particular base emitter junction. Or else what you can do is you can separately bias this base emitter junction by means of another battery, that is VB is equal to 2 volt. And then after the biasing is over, obviously some current will be developed, some voltage will be developed over here, some DC biasing current, base current, collector current will be flowing through the circuit. And you can also find out what is the collector potential under DC condition. This is the corresponding output terminal, which is nothing but the collector terminal of the circuit, I mean, of the particular device. And then you are going to apply the small signal VS, which is a time-varying signal, and you're going to multiply or magnify this particular signal by means of the gain of this particular circuit. So the problem is, all the values are specified over here. Apart from that, the device parameters beta, that is the current gain, is provided as 120. And it is also mentioned that the early voltage is equal to infinite. Now, if the early voltage is given like infinite, then you need not to compute the corresponding value of R0, because R0 is going to be infinite. And if some infinite resistance is connected between the collector to emitter terminals, you can safely neglect that value, that particular value of resistance, because it is connected in parallel with a value equal to infinite. So here the problem is, you need to find out the value of GM. What is the value of GM? What is the value of RPi? You have to calculate RPi. What is the value of R0? So it can be easily obtained that R0 is equal to infinite, because V equal to infinite. And obviously, the voltage gain of the circuit. So that's a new term. You have to find out the voltage gain of the circuit as well. So here, unlike the previous problem, you have to find it out, the value of GM and RPi. In the last problem, GM and RPi was given, and from that you have to find out ICQ and beta just by putting the corresponding value into the equation, into the formula. But here you have to deduce the in-depth thing. So first of all, in the DC analysis, so here whenever we are trying to analyze this one, so we have two different way of solving this problem. First of all, we have to calculate this value of GM, RPi, and R0, because as you know, these are the fundamental components in constituting the corresponding small signal model of the transistor. Once again, if I go back over here, you find that RPi, GM, and R0. So these are the fundamental components. So once you know this component, then only you can go for solving the small signal model. And in order to obtain this value, RPi, GM, and R0, you need to know the DC biasing condition, because all of these three values, GM, RPi, and R0, they are dependent upon the DC current and the corresponding voltages. As you know, RPi is given by VT upon IBQ. GM is given by ICQ upon VT. R0 is given by VA upon ICQ. So until and unless you know the value of IBQ and ICQ, it will not be possible for you to find out what is the value of GM and what is the value of RPi. So that's why you have to analyze the circuit. Now, while you are trying to find out the DC current that is flowing through the circuit, then the circuit gets modified. Under this condition, here I'm assuming that the transistor under consideration or the amplifier itself is a linear device. So since it's a linear device, so therefore the theory of superposition must hold good. That means the overall output, because of the application of two different types of inputs. One input is obviously the DC input like VB, VCC. These are the DC input, the battery, constant voltage. And second one is AC input signal or time varying signal like VS. You could also have some current source as well. Instead of having VS, you could also have some IS as well. So these are the time varying components. So we would like to find out the overall observation over here. What will be the value? What will be the V naught value over here? So that V naught is obtained because of the application of both VS and VBB and VCC. So since the amplifier itself is a linear one, I'm assuming that the amplifier is a linear one, it obeys the theory of superposition. So what I can do is I can analyze the circuit from two different perspectives. First one is known as the DC analysis, in which case only the DC sources will be active and all the AC sources will be made inactive. And then in the second phase, I would do the reversing. That means during the AC analysis, all the DC sources will be inactive and the AC sources will be active. And then the final output is nothing but the algebraic sum of the output obtained with the DC input and the AC input. So that is the fundamental concept behind any superposition theorem, behind analyzing any circuit which follows the superposition theorem. So if I start with analyzing the circuit where the DC sources are active, then the circuit reduces like this. So VCC is there, obviously, because it's a DC signal, I mean, DC supply. This resistance, so this resistance, as long as you have resistance in the circuit, so it will be there in the AC analysis as well as in the DC analysis, because these elements, resistances, they are not sensitive to the frequency of operation. However, if you have capacitor, if you have inductor, then accordingly, you have to model the circuit or you have to modify the circuit. And obviously, this AC source, this VS will be inactive. Now, you have a voltage source. So how to make it inactive? You have to make these two terminals short-circuited so that it could have been made inactive. Instead of having this voltage source, if you have some current source, then what you need to do is that these two points should be open-circuited. So since we have the voltage source, to make it inactive, these two points should be short-circuited. So accordingly, these two are connected together and you have this VBB here, this one. So this one is VCC, this one is RC, you have RB over here and VB over here. So with this, now what we can do is we can analyze the circuit. We can apply the KVL, Kirchhoff's voltage law, this base emitter loop, assuming that the current which is flowing through this is given by IBQ. And what you can find it out here is VB is equal to IBQ times RB. Plus, obviously, there is certain voltage difference between the base to emitter junction of the transistor and that voltage difference, which is known as the VB on. So normally it is given. If it is not given, you can safely assume the value to be 0.7. So now from that expression, you can easily find out the value of IBQ that is given by VB minus VBE on upon RB. So this one is 2 volt minus you have 0.7 volt. And RB is given by 250. So normally the value of RB is large in order to ensure that the base current which is flowing through the circuit is in the range of microampere so that the transistor does not move into the saturation region. So that's why that is the reason because of which the value of Rp is normally chosen to be on the higher side. So it's basically 250k. So 2 minus 0.7 will give you 1.3. 1.3 by 250k. So if I do this calculation, 1.3 by 250k will give you 5.2 into 10 to the minus 3. And 1.3 upon 250 will give you 5.2 into 10 to the minus 3. And apart from this, we have some kilo-ohms over here. So another 10 to the minus 3. So ultimately, the resultant value will be 5.2 into 10 to the minus 6. That means 5.2 microampere. So that is the value of IBQ, the quiescent base current. So once you find out this quiescent base current, then you can easily calculate the quiescent collector current. The formula is very simple. ICQ is equal to beta times IBQ. So beta is equal to 120 here. So if you multiply, you'll be getting the value to be 0.624 milliampere. 0.624 milliampere. So once you get this IBQ and ICQ, now you can easily find out this GM and RPi, because that can be obtained directly from the formula itself. So RPi or GM is given by ICQ upon VT. So ICQ we have already got like 0.624 milliampere, and VT is 26 or 25.5 millivolt. So in volt, it is 0.026. So if I do this calculation, it is coming like 24 milliampere per volt. That is the value for GM. And you can calculate RPi from two different equation. Either you use GM RPi equal to beta, or you use RPi is equal to VT upon IBQ. So here VT is equal to 0.026 volt, and IBQ was 5.2 micro, 10 to the power minus 6. So 0.026 divided by 5.2. Then ultimately it is 5 into 10 to the minus 3, and it gets multiplied with 10 to the power plus 6. Then ultimately it is coming like 5 kilo ohms. And obviously R naught, as you know, R naught is given by VA upon IC. As long as the value of VA is infinite, so no matter what the actual value of ICQ is, whether it is 10 milliampere or 20 milliampere or 30 milliampere, as long as VA is equal to infinite, as specified here, so R naught is going to be infinite. Now, with these three basic parameters at our hand, now we can proceed further towards the development or towards the synthesis of the small signal model. And that is very important, how to draw the corresponding small signal model from the circuit itself. So let me just draw the circuit once again here so that you can compare the small signal model and the circuit side by side. So that is all about the small signal model. I mean the circuit, and we have to find out the small signal model from this. So this one is VS and this one is VB. Now, in order to draw the small signal model, first of all, we have to draw the corresponding small signal model pertaining with the transistor itself. So what we have is, we have this base emitter junction. So we have this one RPi, which is connected between, so let me call this is my base terminal, and let me call this is my emitter terminal. So between these two,
sir,
we have RPi, yes.
So for sir, for the previous one, sir, for finding RCQ and RBQ, sir, we just took the DC voltage. But we ignored the AC one.
No, we have not actually ignored. So okay.
Sir, for superposition, we need both the values.
Yeah. Let me clarify your doubt. You just take a look at this particular graph. That is the variation of IB versus with respect to VBE. So what is R pi? Basically, R pi is nothing but the variation of or the variation of this input voltage with respect to the input current. So as you understand from this graph, it's basically an exponential graph. So how to find it out? The R pi, which is nothing but the inverse of the slope. Slope is given by del IB by del VB. So the inverse of the slope is nothing but R pi. Now, if you just want to compute the value of R pi, and as it is not a straight line, rather it's an exponential one, so therefore the corresponding slope will increase, because e to the power mx, if you consider e to the power mx or e to the power x, if you consider the differentiation of this particular value is equal to e to the power m into e to the power mx, just like this. So as a matter of fact, if you just one second, if you just observe, okay, I would like to take the slope at this particular point. So here the straight line, the corresponding tangent is almost parallel to the x-axis. So here the corresponding slope will be zero. So as you are moving, as you're increasing the value of VB, you will find that the corresponding slope is going to be increased. So the slope is not constant, that you have to remember. So slope is not constant. So the value of R pi, what we are measuring, it's not actually constant. So here our concept of small signal is that with respect to this DC biasing point, VBQ and IBQ, the corresponding fluctuation of the input voltage is very small. For example, I can say that suppose this VBQ is equal to, say, let me consider this to be 0.7 volt. Now, over and above the 0.7 volt, the corresponding fluctuation of the input voltage is like, say 10 millivolt, 10 millivolt plus, 10 millivolt minus. So 0.7 volt means how much? That is 700 millivolt. 0.7 volt means 700 millivolt. So 700 millivolt is the DC biasing point. Now, over and above the 700 millivolt, the corresponding AC fluctuation is like, say, plus 10 to minus 10. So the overall signal, if I just consider the composite signal will vary from 690 millivolt to 710 millivolt. So that is the fluctuation. So you must appreciate that the fluctuation of these small signals, that's why the name of the small signal, the fluctuation of this time varying signal with respect to the DC voltage is not that much. So therefore, if I assume that within that particular span, the small span, I may safely assume that this e to the power x can be considered to be, this segment of the exponential graph can be considered to be constant. Mathematically, I can also say that e to the power x, if we just expand the expression, you'll find that 1 plus x plus, then the higher term, x squared, x cube, and all. Now, if that fluctuation is considered to be small, x squared, x cube, and all, then you can safely neglect that one. And ultimately, this e to the power x can be treated as simple 1 plus x. So that's why during the calculation of R pi, although you are true that R pi is not fixed, R pi depends upon the exact value of R pi will depend upon the value of the input signal, whether the input signal is at 700 millivolt or the input signal is at 705 millivolt or 710 millivolt or 690 millivolt or 695 millivolt. So depending upon that, the corresponding IB value is also going to be changed. So I cannot equate this R pi to VT by IBQ, rather I can approximate R pi to VT by IBQ, assuming that this slope is constant. So therefore, this is the value of R pi. But you must not get confused with the computation of R pi with the computation of the small signal voltage gain or small signal current gain. Okay. So the R pi, although it is not constant, it depends upon the input voltage. But since the variation of the input voltage is small with respect to the DC operating point, so I can safely assume it to be constant. And that value is taken at the DC operating point, at IBQ, at ICQ. So once you can, and the same approach is also taken for the calculation of GM and R0. So once I get this one, so this one is your base and emitter junction, fine. And since it's a common emitter term, common emitter configuration, as you know, because the input is applied between the base and the ground, and the emitter is grounded itself. So now emitter is grounded, fine. And between collector to emitter, you have GM times Vpi. And this voltage is Vpi, the voltage across base to emitter for an NPN transistor. For PNP transistor, the polarity will be reversed. And obviously, you'd be having some R0 in parallel with this GM Vpi current source. But already you have calculated Rpi to R0 to be infinite. Now, Rpi to be infinite means what? These two terminals basically open circuited. So there is no need to connect Rpi, R0 here. So that is all about the internal structure of the transistor. What we have Rpi, we have GM times Vpi only. So we can get rid of R0 for this particular problem. Now that is all about the transistor itself. But the circuit is not computed, because apart from that, you have some other elements like Rb and Rc. Now how to connect them? Now to connect them, Rb and Rc, so how is Rb connected? So one terminal of Rb is connected at the base, and the other terminal is connected with the voltage source in series. So if I have a voltage source like this, Vs, small signal, which you are going to magnify or amplify, so that is Vs. So Rb is connected between these two in series like this. What about Rc? One terminal of Rc is connected at the collector terminal. So this is the, I forgot to mention, this is a collector terminal. And this one is once again the emitter terminal. And remember, emitter is grounded. What about Rc? How to connect Rc? One end of Rc is obviously at the collector terminal. That is fine. So we have to connect Rc from this terminal. What about the other end? The other end is connected to VCC, that is the supply voltage. But remember, here we are constructing the small signal model. Now, during the construction of the small signal model, all the DC voltage sources or DC signal sources will be made inactive. So if I have some VCC over here, so that is the DC supply voltage, and that can be treated as AC ground, because there is no fluctuation of VCC. If I assume that the supply voltage is a constant one, is an ideal one, that means it will provide a constant supply, constant voltage over a longer period of time. Say VCC is equal to 5 volt. So there is no fluctuation with respect to time, because it's a DC signal. So with respect to AC, so whenever we are constructing the circuit for the small signal, for the AC signal, then VCC, since it's a DC one, so it doesn't have any fluctuation. So as far as the AC perspective is concerned, this is considered to be having a value of zero. So one end of RC is connected to the collector terminal, and the other end is connected to the AC ground. This is connected to VCC, and VCC is nothing but AC ground. So whenever you find any DC supply in the circuit, in the small signal equivalent circuit, this DC supply will be treated as AC ground. And this ground is also the AC ground, because we are constructing here, we are drawing the circuit for the AC analysis. So we need to connect. So what we can do is we can directly connect this RC between collector and emitter. Although it is not connected between collector and emitter in the circuit itself, but in the small signal model, they are connected. RC is connected between collector and the ground. And emitter is already grounded, so I can consider this to be RC. And what about VBB or VP? Once again, in the AC model, this one is made inactive. So this is the DC ground, this terminal is the DC ground and this terminal is AC ground. So therefore, this is also connected together. So what I can do is I can directly connect these two terminals together because both of them are AC ground. And we have to take the output from this particular end, that is V naught. So now, if you just apply the Ohm's law over here, what will be V naught? V naught is nothing but, so GM V pi is flowing in that direction. So that is the direction of GM V pi. And when we are writing down the expression for V naught, so we are assuming the V naught is nothing but the collector potential with respect to the ground. Now the current is flowing from this end to this end. That means this terminal is much more positive with respect to this terminal. Now this terminal is already zero, ground, AC ground. So therefore this terminal will be at minus GM V pi RC because the current that is flowing is GM V pi. So V naught is equal to minus GM V pi into RC. That is quite obvious. And what about the V pi? Because ultimately, the voltage gain is given by the ratio between V naught and Vs. But V naught is not equal to Vs here. As you find here, we have some base resistance RB. So therefore, this is not exactly equal to Vs. Rather, what we can do is we can simply apply KVL over here, and you can write down Vs as a function of V pi or vice versa. What you can find is V pi is given by, so you have two different resistance RB and R pi. So if you simply analyze that particular loop, so it's nothing but R pi upon RB plus R pi multiplied with Vs. So now you can simply put the value over here. So it is coming like minus GM R pi. Then we have RC multiplied with Vs divided by RB plus R pi. And that is equal to minus, so already you know GM R pi is nothing but beta. So beta RC divided by RB plus R pi multiplied with Vs. So let me go to the next slide. So what we have got is we have got V naught, the output voltage, equal to minus beta RC divided by RB plus R pi into Vs. So the voltage gain AV is V naught upon Vs. And since we are considering the common emitter configuration, so obviously this voltage gain here is negative. There is a phase difference between the input and output of 180 degree. But if we want to calculate the gain only, I mean the magnitude only, then it is given by beta RC by RB plus R pi. Now you have all the values with you. You know the value of beta. Beta was given like 120. RC was given like, let me check the value of RC. What we specified, RC was 4 kilo ohm. So it was 4K. And RB, we have mentioned RB to be 250K. And R pi we have calculated to be 5 kilo ohms. So if you do this calculation, it's pretty simple. 120 into 4 will give you 480 upon 255. So it's coming like minus 1.88. So the gain is not that much. It's only minus 1.88. Or if you just consider the magnitude, so mod of this gain is approximately 1.88. Less than 2. So there are several factors by means of which you can enhance the gain. Because we have started with a very simple circuit. So we don't have the other important considerations into this particular circuit. So we will be taking up those problems gradually. But to start with, what I can tell you This is a very simple way to calculate the voltage gain of a simple common emitter amplifier circuit.
Sir.
Now, yeah.
Sir, we initially wanted to do this problem in two steps, right? First, we wanted to make the DC active and AC inactive, and then we wanted to make the AC active and DC inactive. That is how we yes. wanted to proceed with the problem, right?
Yeah.
Sir, so first we did that DC active and AC inactive, but in the next step, we considered the small signal model, sir. That
yeah, small signal model means what? AC active and DC inactive.
Sir, but
and
this
here
also
we are finding out the gain only. Okay.
Oh, okay, sir.
Here we are finding out the gain only. For example, okay, to answer your query, okay, so let me just give you another important observations. Let me just consider the circuit once again. Yeah. So what you find is, in the DC part, what you find is we have already calculated ICQ and IBQ. So we can also calculate, although it is not given in the problem itself, but we can also calculate what is the VCEQ. That is another important term, VCEQ here. That means what? The output potential under DC condition, because here the emitter terminal is grounded. So VCEQ is nothing but the output potential under DC condition. So how to find it out, this voltage, which is very simple, VCC minus ICRC drop. So that is equal to VCC minus ICQ RC. So VCC is given like 5 volt and ICQ is given like 0.6 to 4 milliampere. We have 0.6. 4 milliampere and RC is equal to 4 kilo ohms. So together it is 2.496, almost 0.5. So if you just
so VCEQ is basically V naught, right?
V naught under DC condition. Whenever I'm writing Q, Q means the quiescent condition. Under DC condition. So this V naught is having two different components. One is the DC component, second one is AC component. Okay. So that V naught, I should write like this. Yes. This output V out is equal to all caps V out plus small V out. So that is the normally we refer this total instantaneous signal or total instantaneous current or voltage as a summation of the DC and AC part. So whenever we are referring DC, that is all caps, all capital letter, capital V and capital out. And when we are trying to identify the AC component, the small signal component, that is all small. And their summation is nothing but the total instantaneous voltage. So here to identify this one, the actual variable is represented in small and the subscript has been represented in capital. So that is the identification. So I'm coming to that. So what we are finding here is V out, capital V out, which is nothing but the VCEQ. Output voltage under DC condition is obtained like 2.504 volt. So that is the voltage, 2.504 volts. So whenever that was absent, this VS was absent, we have applied VB like 2 volt, some 250 kilo ohms were there, and we have some 5 volt supply from this terminal. We have 4 kilo ohms resistance. So what about the voltage developed at this particular point? That is 2.504 volt. And perfectly designed because here the maximum voltage could have been 5 volt, minimum voltage could have been 0 volt. Ideally, practically it should be some 0.2 volt or so. And between this 5 volt and 0.2 volt, this is placed midway, 2.504. So that's why the circuit, the components have been selected in proper way so that the maximum excursion of the output signal is possible. So 2.504 volt. So now if I just want to observe the output as a function of time, So this is the output V. Okay, let me write it down like V out. Now, this is the DC part, which is equal to 2.504 fold. Whenever you have not applied any input signal, I mean the small signal, then also this 2.504 volt was there. And that is the constant voltage, because you have applied all the signals to be constant, 5 volt constant, 2 volt constant, 250 kilo ohms constant, 4 kilo ohms constant. So all of them are constant. So therefore, the voltage that will be developed over here, this is also constant. And that voltage is 2.504 volt. Remember, this voltage, this collector potential can go up to 5 volt only, not more than 5 volt, because 5 volt is the maximum supply. So if this current is equal to zero, if the current flowing through this RC is equal to zero, then there is no drop across RC, then this voltage will be 5 volt, max to max. And minimum voltage that can be attained by this particular terminal is equal to 0 volt, ideally. But practically, you know, that particular situation will happen when the transistor enters into the saturation region. And for any low power transistor, this VC saturation voltage will be at least 0.2 to 0.3 volt. So at least 0.2 volt, if you just keep aside, so the minimum voltage will be 0.2 volt and the maximum voltage will be 5 volt. So under any circumstances, the total instantaneous voltage, that means this one, this small V capital out, this one, can never be higher than 5 volt and can never be less than 0.2 volt. Now, let us consider, we are applying on input signal like this. Let me take an input signal, Vs to be 0.8 sine 100t. That is input signal. So as you understand, it's a sinusoidal signal with peak at 0.8 and negative peak at minus 0.8. So that has been applied over here. And we are interested in finding out the corresponding output voltage, what we are getting over here at this particular terminal over here. What will be the nature of the output voltage when you have applied this signal? So already what you have got is the gain of this particular circuit is given by 1.88. And we have applied an input signal Vs to be 0.8 sine of 100t. So for the timing, forget about this 100t, because we are now in the unit 3, in which case the frequency response characteristics is not considered. Only you just try to understand what about the peak value of the input. The peak value was 0.8. Now, there is a magnification by 1.88. There is a magnification, so let me show you the input signal. How does it look like? So input signal looks something like that. If I just want to draw a single cycle, so this is 0.8. And obviously, this is minus 0.8, as you understand. This is minus 0.8. Now, because of the circuit, there is an amplification, because it's an amplifier. So this 0.8, that value gets multiplied with 1.88. So ultimately, what you are getting is 0.8 and 1.88 will give you 1.504. It will give you 1.504. So this one will be 0.8. So that particular value will become 1.504. So after magnification, if I just want to observe the small signal component only the small signal component, only the time varying component, then this fluctuation, once again, it will be sinusoidal signal. It's the same frequency, but two different changes you can observe. So what are the two changes? So I think, I can write this V out. You just try to notice it's all small, V out. Okay. So there will be two different changes with respect to this one, this graph with blue, which I'm going to draw, is the output voltage, instantaneous output, small signal output voltage, not the total instantaneous, small signal output voltage, keeping aside the DC term. So you will find that there are two changes. One is the gain is there, that the gain, the value of the gain is 1.88, and already I have computed. If I multiply this 1.88 with 0.8, it will become 1.504. And the second change is that there is a minus sign over here. That means there is a phase difference of 180 degree. So, although not perfectly drawn, but anyway, you can understand hopefully. So this will be the output voltage. I mean, this will be the small signal component with this one at 1.504. Let me here only. So there is a phase difference of 180 degree. And this value, as you can understand, this value is 1.504, but there is a phase difference, 1.504 volt. So now, if I would like to obtain this one, small v capital out, which is nothing but, so what is small v capital out? So small v capital out, that is the total instantaneous output voltage that you are getting at this terminal, output terminal, is nothing but this v out, which you have already drawn by means of the straight line, plus this small v out, which we have already got like this. Okay, so now if I want to draw this one, let me just change the color so that let me draw with red, small v capital out. So that is a total instantaneous output voltage. So already you have 2.504, and over and above this, you have this 1.504 sine 100t with a negative sign outside. So then it will be like, let me draw in proper scale. It will be 1 volt. So 2.504 minus 1.504, so it will be 1 volt. So somehow here. So this is the final output voltage. So you have applied a signal like this, a 0.8 sine 100t at the input of the amplifier, and what you are getting at the output is this red graph that you will be getting, because here you find the input signal. I mean, input signal is basically riding on a 0 DC. 0.8 sine 100t. So there is no DC associated with input signal. But if you simply apply this input signal to the circuit itself, then during the negative half cycle, the base emitter junction will never be forward biased unless you provide a particular bias. So that's why this VBB of 2 volt has been given, so that even during the negative half cycle, whenever the input signal goes negative, the amplifier or the transistor doesn't enter into the cutoff region. So here you find whenever the input signal goes negative, then also the operation of the transistor, operation of the amplifier is not hampered. And ultimately, you can retain the shape of the particular graph. The variation is like this, a sinusoidal signal. You can retain the shape. There is no change obtained here. As far as the shape is concerned, only there is a phase difference of 180 degree, and obviously the frequency is also remaining constant. So that value, if you just compute this value, is nothing but 1 volt. Because 2.504 and here you have minus 1.504, if you just add them together, it will be 1 volt. And this value will be, this is 2.504 plus 1.504. That means 4.008. So the interesting thing to note here is that this output voltage, this overall output voltage, under no circumstances it can go beyond 5 volt, and under no circumstances it can go below 0.2 volt. So here you find the minimum value is 1 volt, maximum is 4 point. So 1 to 4 volts. If I just neglect this fractional term after the point, so here you find is the variation is from 1 volt to 4 volt. So very evenly poised between the minimum level and the maximum level of the output voltage. So under no circumstances, once again, if I go back to the original circuit, under no circumstances this voltage can be greater than 5 volt or less than 0.2 volt. Okay.
So could you please tell about the 0.2 volt?
0.2 volt. Yeah, when there is enormous amount of current flowing through the transistor, that means the transistor is going into the saturation region. Then what you find is V naught is given by VCC minus ICRC. That is obtained clearly from the KVL itself. Now, if the value of VCC is constant, that is 5 volt. Now, if enormous amount of collector current flows to the circuit, then the transistor moves from the active region to the saturation region. And as you know, in the saturation region, this collector current and the base current, they never follow this equation like IC is equal to beta times IV, right? So enormous amount of current will be flowing and ICRC drop will be very much close to 5 volt. And whenever the transistor enters into the saturation region, then this value of this collector to emitter drop, that is getting saturated at 0.2 volt for any low power transistor. So if you just once again remember what about the transistor characteristics curve, VI characteristics, output characteristics, IC versus VC, then you can. So initially you have cutoff region like this. Then you have the active region, and if enormous amount of current flows to the circuit, then here you find that it gets saturated at 0. And so that value is like 0.2 volt.
Okay.
0.1 to 0.2 volt. Okay. Anyway, so let me move to the to our next problem. So the previous problem was very much associated with a simple circuit. The biasing arrangement was not that complicated. Now, in this problem, we'll be giving another circuit in which case the corresponding transistor is a PNP transistor, and you have to find out the quiescent point and obviously the voltage gain of the circuit. And so the circuit looks something like that. Now the biasing is a voltage divider kind of biasing. Just like this. Now we have some PNP transistor. This one is emitter terminal, this one is the collector terminal for the PNP transistor. So VCC is equal to say 12 volt. And this is R1, that is 10 kilo ohms. This is R2, voltage divider bias, that is equal to 50 kilo ohms. You have RC here, that is 2 kilo ohms. You have RE, emitter resistance, that is equal to 1 kilo ohms. That is all about the circuit. Now you need to apply the, obviously through this voltage divider bias, the corresponding base emitter junction will get the corresponding forward bias. So there is no need additionally to connect a voltage source over here, the DC supply, because that can be obtained directly through this particular arrangement. And what about the signal that you're going to amplify? The signal looks like this. Now this is connected through a coupling capacitor. So what is the role of this coupling capacitor? This coupling capacitor will prevent the DC current to enter into the signal source. That is Vs. So it is given beta to be 100, Va to be infinite. So there is no need to calculate R naught or to take R naught into account during your calculation, and other values are given already. We'll be taking the output from the connected terminal.
And so can you please repeat the use of the coupling capacitor?
Yes, coupling. What is the role of having a coupling capacitor over here? Suppose, what is our purpose here? So here we have some signal source. As you have seen last time also, we have some 0.8 volt, 0.8 sine of 100t, which is going to be magnified by the circuit itself, amplifier circuit itself. Now, we don't know whether the signal that you're going to magnify is already having some DC component or not. Might be the 0. Like if I just consider this one, let us consider this signal. Suppose this is riding on 0 DC, like this. This is riding on a 0 DC. Or the same signal. So we are designing the circuit for any type of the input signal. Suppose this is my input. That means the input doesn't have any AC DC component, only some AC fluctuation is there. Now, this could also have been my input, but that input is having some positive DC, or that can also be my input. Everywhere you'll find that the same fluctuation. If you just compute this this variation from this point to this point, peak to peak, so in all these three cases, the peak to peak magnitude being the same, say 10 millivolt peak to peak or 20 millivolt peak to peak. But what about the absolute value of the input signal? So here it is 10 millivolt, here it is more than 10 millivolt, like say 12 millivolt, and here it is less than 10 millivolt, like say 5 millivolt or so. So now you don't know whether this is applied to your signals, to your system, or this is applied or this one. Now, if these three different signals are having three different DC component, that is definitely going to affect the biasing condition of the circuit itself. So what is our purpose here? Here our purpose is to magnify this fluctuation. If it is say 10 millivolt, I would like to make it like say 1000 millivolt with a gain of 100. Suppose this one is 10 millivolt peak to peak, with a design of particular amplifier, I would like to make it like 1000, so the gain of 100. So that is needed from the particular circuit. So we are not interested whether it is riding on a 0 DC or some non-zero DC. And even if for a non-zero DC, whether it is riding on a positive DC or on a negative DC. So we have to take these different calculations, or these different terms, just beyond our consideration. That means somehow we have to block the appearance of DC into the main circuit. So how we can do that? In order to do that, we have to use one capacitor, because as you know, the capacitor is providing the maximum impedance, ideal infinite impedance, to the DC signal. The corresponding impedance, if you calculate for any capacitor, that is given by 1 upon j omega c. So if omega equal to 0, that means for a DC signal, the capacitor will provide the infinite impedance. So if you just pass, so if I suppose, let me call over here, let me call here the input that we're getting at this particular end is Vs dashed. So if I do not have this capacitor, then Vs and Vs dashed will be the same. But if we have this capacitor, then what we have is capacitor will retain only the fluctuation. The DC component is immaterial to the capacitor, because if the DC component somehow gets reflected into the circuit itself, then it is going to modify the already existing biasing condition, the already existing base current, collect DC base current, DC collector current, DC collector to emitter voltage and all. Now, if I have a capacitor like this, and if I have these three different inputs having same fluctuation but riding on a different DC, you'll find that for all of them, this Vs dashed will look like this. That means all of them will be riding on zero DC, because this DC will be blocked by the capacitor. So if I call this is one, and this is say A, this is B, and this is C, you'll find that if I have the capacitor, then Vs dashed for all of them will be the same. That means all the signals are having, even if they are having some non-zero DC, but that DC component will be suppressed by the capacitor. So that is one of the important purpose. And the second important purpose is that whenever you have a circuit like this and you have some DC current that is flowing through this circuit, now this capacitor, this particular capacitor, will also prevent any DC current to enter into the signal source, because it will basically prevent the DC signal. So all the DC current that will be flowing through, so because of the application of this 12 volt supply, the DC current that you're measuring, the base current and all, so that will be flowing only this path, 10 kilos, 15 kilos through this path. So at this particular point, so there is a possibility that one part of the current might flow into this if I don't have any capacitor over here. But if I have a capacitor over here, so then this DC current doesn't find any path to flow into the signal source. So that's why this is known as a DC blocking capacitor or coupling capacitor. Okay, so what you need to do is that for this particular circuit, initially you need to find out the quiescent operating point and then the voltage gain of the circuit. What about the voltage gain and what about the quiescent operating point of this particular circuit? Now, this particular circuit falls under the category of the voltage divider bias, right? So to analyze this circuit, so you have to apply. So if I consider this terminal, suppose this is my point X. So at point X, we have to apply this Thevenin voltage, and accordingly, we need to find out the equivalent Thevenin equivalent voltage and Thevenin equivalent resistance. Now, initially, we are performing the DC analysis. So obviously, during the DC analysis, this Vs and CC will not be there at all. So we have a simple circuit like this. We have a simple circuit. So we do have for the DC analysis, we have circuit like this. We have now PNP transistor. We have a PNP transistor here. And RC. That's all. And we have VCC here. What about the voltage at this particular point? So I have to apply Thevenin equivalent, I mean Thevenin's theorem, to find out the Thevenin equivalent voltage and the corresponding resistance. Now, what about the Thevenin equivalent resistance here? So that resistance, so from this particular circuit, what I need to have is, I need to transform the circuit like this. At this point, So this one is VCC with RE. This one is RC, ground. Now what I need to have is, I need to find out the equivalent resistance, that is RTH, and the corresponding Thevenin voltage at this particular point, so that the analysis will be simple. So how to find out the Thevenin equivalent resistance? This is very simple. This is nothing but the parallel combination of this R1 and R2. So R Thevenin is given by R1 parallel R2. And in our case, one is 10 kilo ohms, second one is 50 kilo ohms. So 10 into 50 divided by 10 plus 50. So 500 by 60. So it will give you 500 divided by 60, give you 8.33 kilo ohms. So Thevenin equivalent resistance will be 8.33 kilo ohms. And the VThevenin value, which is equal to, as you know, this one is R2 upon R1 plus R2 into VCC. Into VCC. So R2 is given by 50. R1 plus R2 will be 10 plus 50 multiplied with VCC is 12 volt. So then it is 50 upon 60, 5 by 6, so it is 10 volt. So now my circuit gets reduced to this one. We have some 10 volt here. We have some 8.33 kilo ohms. And apart from that, now we have this RE resistance and this VCC, and we have this RC. So now what you can do is we can apply this Kirchhoff's voltage law between this base emitter loop. In the base emitter loop, now what we have is we have VCC here, and the current will be flowing through this path. Current will be flowing through this path. And that current is given by the emitter current, that is 1 plus beta times the base current. And then you have between emitter to base, now this emitter to base voltage should be positive. This time it will be 0.7 volt or so, because it's a PNP transistor. For NPN transistor, this base emitter voltage should be 0.7 volt. And for PNP transistor, the emitter base voltage should be 0.7 volt. And then you have this that difference, the voltage drop across this resistance, RThevenin, that is IBQ into RThevenin, and plus VThevenin. Because VCC, if you just consider here, so it's positive 12 volt, and then they are all drops. If the current flows in this direction, so plus to minus, so this terminal is much more positive with respect to this terminal. Then once again, emitter to base, VEB on is also positive, like 0.7 volt or so. Then current is flowing in this direction. So once again, plus to minus. So there is a voltage drop, and then once again, plus to minus. So all of these different drops will be added together. And that is equal to VCC. So what we have, VCC is equal to IEQ times RE plus VEB on. VEB on plus then you have IBQ times RTH plus VTH. So now we don't have any data about IBQ. So it is 1 plus beta times IBQ into RE plus VB on plus IBQ into RTH plus VTH. So we have some available data with us. VCC is given, VTH we have calculated, RTH we have calculated, beta we know. Beta is 100. So we have 12 here. So let me go to the next slide. So VCC was 12. Minus VB on is 0.7 volt, minus VTH we have calculated like 10. So that gets equal to beta is given by 100. So 1 plus beta times IBQ. So 100 plus 1. So 101 times IBQ into RE. And RE is given like, I think RE was 1 kilo ohm and RC was 2 kilo ohm. Okay, fine. So RE is 1 kilo ohm. So 101. Into IBQ. Remember that the value of IBQ, what you are getting, will be in milliampere, because already we have taken into account this 1 kilo during the calculation. And then we have IBQ multiplied with RTH. So RTH is 8.50 kilo ohms. So you have 8.33 IBQ. So the resultant value of IBQ will be in milliampere. So what we have, 12 minus 10, that is 2, 2 minus 0.7, that is 1.3. So in the numerator, you have 1.3. And in the denominator, we have 109.33. So this amount, this of milliampere, 1.3 upon 109.33. So after calculation, what you find is 0.0119 milliampere. That means 11.9 microampere. So this is the amount of current which will be flowing as the base current under DC condition. So if this one is given IBQ, so you can easily find out what is the value of ICQ. So ICQ is given by beta times IBQ. Beta is 100. So 11.9 micro amps into 100 will give you, so 100 10 to the minus 4, that means 1.19 milliampere. 1.19 milliampere. That is ICQ. And then you have to find out the VCE value, VCE under DC condition. What is the voltage difference between these two terminals, VCE? So how to find it out, VCE, the drop between these two points, which is nothing but VCC minus the drop across these two resistances, that is IEQRE and ICQRC. So that will be VCEQ. So VCEQ is given by VCC minus IEQRD minus ICQRC. So VCC minus, you have 101.
So won't we consider VPE?
No, while calculating VCQ, so you have to apply KVL in the correct emitter loop. Right.
So, but there also we have to go through that 0.7 drop.
No, 0.7 drop is here only. The input loop. From here to here. From collector to emitter, we have 0.0. From collector to emitter, we have to find it out, this one. So you have two different components, two different segments. One is the input loop, second one is output. So from this point, what is the drop? You have VCC here. Then RE, that is connected between VCC and the collect emitter terminal, and then emitter to collector, that drop we are trying to find out, that voltage difference, and then this point to this point, this to ground. Then the circuit is completed, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Whenever you are doing this calculation, now VTH, so one end is connected to RTH, other end is connected to ground, fine. Then RTH, one end is connected to VTH, other end to the base. Then base to emitter, so base to emitter this way, and then you have this RE, and accordingly VCC. So you have to follow this path. You have to follow this path during the calculation of IBQ, and during the calculation of VCQ, you have to follow this output path. Okay.
Yes, I got it.
So 101, what you have got, 101 times RE was 1 kilo ohm. So, okay, 101 IB will be there. So IB. So it will be better if I write 101 into 101K into IB minus, it's simply 100. Okay. No, it's not 100 because RC is 2 kilo ohms. So it will be 200K into IB. That means VCC minus 301 K into IB. That means 12 volt minus 301 into 10 to the power 3 into 11.9 into 10 to the power minus 6. So that calculation will give you 301 into 11.9 will give you 3581.9 into 10 to the minus 3, that is 3.5819. So 12 minus 3.5819. And 12 minus 3.5819 will give you 8.4181. 8.4181 volt. So what we have got is we have got VCQ. We have also got ICQ. So now we are in a position to, first of all, we can draw the DC load line. So how to draw the DC load line? So you must be knowing that there are two different axes, and they are the output parameters, output voltage, and output current, VCE versus IC. Now, what you need to do is that I have to find out, you know, to draw the DC load line, first of all, I have to find out two extreme points. That means the value of VCE, when IC is equal to zero, and value of IC when VC is equal to zero. So to get that, that means I would like to find out one point over here, the value of IC when VC is equal to zero, and one point over here, the value of VC when IC is equal to zero. So if I once again go back to the original circuit, so the value of here only. So first of all, when the value of IC is equal to zero, I need to find out what is the value of VCE. Now, if IC is equal to zero, as you understand, IC zero means what? IB zero and IE also zero. That means all the current flowing through this path will be zero. That means there is no drop across RE and RC. And therefore, this entire 12 volt VCC will be dropped across this VCE. So when IC is equal to zero, then the value of VCE is obtained like 12 volt. So let me mark this as 12 volt. When IC is equal to zero, so that is equal to 12 volt, that is VCC. And when VCE is equal to zero, then you can once again solve the expression. I mean, you know this VCC is equal to IEQ RE plus ICQ RC plus VCE. So when IEQ is given by 1 plus beta times IB, IBQ basically, IBQ RE plus beta times IBQ RC plus VCE. So one point I've already got, the value of VCE when IC is equal to zero. And the second term, a second point is yet to be calculated, the value of IC when VCE is equal to zero. So when VCE is equal to zero, you can calculate the value of IBQ from this expression. So in that expression, with VC is equal to zero, if I put this one, VC is equal to zero, it gives me VCC is equal to IBQ into 1 plus beta times RE plus beta times RC. So that is equal to IBQ. So you have 101 into RE, that is 101 plus beta 100, and RC is 2, so 200, so 301. So 301 kilo ohms. And from that, IBQ is coming like 12 volt divided by V01K. It's like 3.98 milliampere. So that would have been the maximum possible current. So in fact, we have considered VC is equal to zero. That is an extreme case, but practically it is never possible because at least you should have some 0.2 volt drop. But we have to, while drawing the DC load line, we have to consider the extreme conditions theoretically. And here we find that, I think I have made some mistake. It can't be milliampere. IBQ can't be milliampere. Let me once again check it. 12 volt divided by 301. It's giving like 0.0398 milliampere. So ICQ we can get just by multiplying this IBQ with 100, and then it will be 3.98 milliampere. That value is for ICQ. So I've directly calculated ICQ. So that is somewhere here. That is 3.98 milliampere. That is the maximum possible current. And then I think it would be wiser for me if I just difficult for me to join these two lines. Anyway, you understand what I meant by that. Now, so backtrack. I don't know. Anyway, let's consider this is my 12 volt, new 12 volt. Difficult. Oh, I have to change all the things. Anyway, so I think it is clearly understood. This one is VCE. So these are the two points. This is 12 volt and this is 3.98 milliampere. And on this particular DC load line, obviously our calculated value of VCQ and ICQ should be there. And so what we have got, like VCQ is like 8.4181 volt with the corresponding ICQ to be 1.19 milliampere. So on this DC load line, this 1.19 and 8.4181, so somewhere over here might be, this might be the operating point with this one to be 8.4181 and this point to be 1.19 milliampere. You can readily check that whether this point will lie on this particular straight line or not just by calculating the slope between these two points and between these two points. Now, if these two slopes are same, then obviously it will be lying. You can cross verify. So anyway, so by means of this, we can find out the DC load line and the quiescent operating. We can also place the quiescent operating point on this particular DC load line. And then your next job is to find out the voltage gain. We need to find out the voltage gain for this particular circuit. So to find out the voltage gain, once again, I have to draw the circuit first. And then we can develop the small signal model from the circuit itself. So the circuit was something like that, if you can remember. we have some capacitor over here, but as of now, the role of the capacitor is either to allow the signal or to suppress the signal. Allow the AC signal and suppress the DC signal. It's a kind of a binary action as of now in unit 3 for the capacitor. So RE, RC, R1, R2, ground. This one is VS. The coupling capacitor over here. So here the idea is to use this particular capacitor so that it can pass the signal, the small signal, from this end to the input of the amplifier. So to draw the small signal equivalent model, first of all, we have to identify the parameters corresponding to the transistor itself. So we have between base to emitter, we must be having R pi. So if I call this my base terminal, this my emitter terminal. So between these two, we must be having R pi. And remember, here we are considering PNP transistor. So if we have PNP transistor, here the description is a little bit different. That means the V pi, the voltage drop between R pi is given by V pi. But for PNP transistor, V pi is measured with respect to the base terminal. Because as you know, for a PNP transistor, the emitter should be at a higher potential with respect to base because it's a PNP transistor. So V pi will be measured like this. So this terminal positive, this terminal negative. And that voltage is V pi. And as a matter of fact, the direction of GM V pi current source will also be opposite GM times V pi. And since in this particular problem, it has been mentioned, hopefully, that the value of VA to be infinite, so we should not be bothered about R0. Otherwise, we have to place this R0 in shunt with GM V pi, in parallel with this GM V pi. So that completes the internal structure of the transistor itself. But still, we have the other components to consider. First of all, let's take a look at this RE. Where can I connect this RE? So RE is connected, in the actual circuit, is connected between the emitter terminal and the VCC. Now in the small signal equivalent model, the RE should be connected. So one end should be at the emitter terminal of the transistor, and the other end should be connected to the AC ground. Because whenever we are designing the small signal equivalent circuit of the amplifier, then VCC, which is equal to the supply, DC supply, is treated as AC ground. So therefore, RE should be connected between emitter terminal to the AC ground. So this time emitter is not grounded. Rather, it is grounded through the resistance RE. So the placement of RE is over. How to place this R1 and R2? Now you have to understand that where can I place this signal source? So obviously signal source is there, just like this. VS. So one end is at AC ground, the other end is connected to the base of the transistor through a coupling capacitor. Now, as I mentioned, that here the role of the coupling capacitor is just like a binary operation. So either it will pass the signal or it will suppress the signal. So either it will be acting as a short circuit or open circuit. Now, for the small signal, the coupling capacitor, as of now, it is acting as a short circuit. So it will not provide any impedance. So the impedance provided by the circuit, provided by this coupling capacitor to the circuit, will be zero. So I can directly connect it to the base. So now here, what you find, here we have, if I just consider this particular terminal, the base terminal, now we have the branching of two resistance. One is R1, second one is R2. So both of them are connected to the base terminal. And the other terminal, R2, is connected to DC ground here, and DC ground is obviously equal to the AC ground. And this terminal, the other terminal of R1, is connected to VCC. So VCC is equal to AC ground during the design of small signal equivalent circuit. So therefore, what we find is these two resistances, although in the actual circuit, they are not connected parallelly in the actual circuit. But whenever we are designing, whenever we are synthesizing the small signal equivalent model, so both of them are connected in shunt path because these two terminals are treated to be equivalent terminal. So R1 and R2, they are connected in parallel from the base terminal to the AC ground. So this is nothing but RThevenin, R1 parallel R2. What is left? RC. Collector resistance is left. So collector resistance should be connected between collector terminal to ground. So I cannot connect collector terminal to emitter terminal because emitter is not grounded here. So the collector resistance RC is connected between this end and ground. So this is RC and we will be taking the output. So output will be taken from this end, VO, and this one is VS. So this one is VO. So that completes the circuit. Okay. Let me make it concise. Yeah. This one is collector, this one is emitter. So now what you need to do is that you have to find out the gain, the voltage gain of the circuit. That means you are asked to find out AV, which is the ratio of these two terms, V0 upon VS. So the calculation of V0 is pretty simple because you have GM Vpi, current is flowing in this direction through RC. You don't have any R0 over here. So it is flowing through RC and the voltage developed across RC is nothing but V0. So very simply you can calculate V0 to be GM Vpi times RC. That is quite obvious. Then the next question is, what is the relation between Vpi and Vs? So here Vpi and Vs are not the same because emitter is not connected to ground. Rather, it is connected to ground through a resistance RD. So now, as you can observe, the current, the direction of the current flow through the resistance RE is from this terminal to that terminal. And this current is nothing but the emitter current. Emitter current is equal to the base current plus the collector current. So what you find is, if I consider for Vs, if I consider this terminal is positive with respect to ground, so here we find it is Vs. From this terminal to ground, the corresponding potential is Vs. Now, if I analyze from this particular perspective, so that voltage is nothing but minus Vpi minus the voltage drop across the resistance RE. So what we can write is Vs is equal to, we just take a look at the polarity. So for Vs, this terminal is positive with respect to ground. So here you have like minus to plus, so plus Vs. And if I analyze the same thing from this particular perspective, so it will be plus to minus, and another plus to minus. So this one is very simple, minus Vpi. And what about this voltage? This voltage is nothing but the voltage drop across the resistance RE. So what is the current that is flowing? So you have two different components of current. One is GM Vpi, second one is Vpi by Rpi. So these are the two components which are flowing, the base current plus the collector current. So Vpi by Rpi is the one component and GM Vpi is the other component of the current. And the resistance is RE. So that is the relation between Vs and Vpi. So if I simplify this one, so it will be minus Vpi minus, you can take Vpi common, then it is coming like 1 by Rpi plus GM times RE So that is equal to minus v pi into, so gmr pi is nothing but beta, so 1 plus beta by r pi into re. So from that, what you can do is you can express v pi as a function of vs. So that is equal to minus v pi into 1 plus beta upon r pi into re. So already we have got these two terms. So we have got like v naught is equal to gm v pi rc and v pi equal to, let me just check once again. So v pi is equal to minus vs upon this one. So v pi is equal to minus vs upon 1 plus, I think 1 plus beta by r pi into re. 1 plus beta by r pi. Into RE. So then the expression for the voltage gain AV, which is equal to V naught upon VS, that is nothing but minus GM RC divided by 1 plus beta by R pi into RE. Now if I multiply the numerator and the denominator by R pi, then it is coming like minus GM R pi RC divided by R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So GM R pi, it is well known that GM R pi is given by beta. So beta times RC divided by R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So this is an interesting expression what you have arrived finally, minus beta RC by R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So that is an exact expression for the voltage gain what you have got, and you can simply put the value of beta over here, like beta to be 100, and you can also put RC to be 2k. So beta to be 100 and RC to be 2 kilo ohms divided by R pi, we have already calculated to be 100. If not, then it can be calculated directly from the value of GM itself. Let me check whether we have calculated R pi or not. No, PTAP, okay, fine. So we have already got ICQ like 1.19 milliampere and IBQ like 11.9 microampere. So from that, we can calculate R pi. So R pi is given by VT upon IBQ. So VT is 0.026 volt divided by 11.9 micro. That means 0.026 into 10 to the power 6. So that means 2660 divided by 11.9. It's coming like 2.184 kilo ohms. So it's coming like 2.184 kilo ohms R pi. So now with this R pi, 2.184 kilo ohms and beta is 100 as specified. So 101 and RD was 1. So 101. Okay. So it's like 200 upon 103.184. So 200 divided by 103.184. And it's coming like 1.938. So minus 1.938. So this is an exact value for the voltage gain. But there is also some possibility to calculate the voltage gain as a rough estimation. What is that estimation? Normally for a circuit like this, you find that although this is an exact expression, but the value of this 1 plus beta times RE is much, much larger as compared to R prime. And that is also evident from the expression itself, 101 with respect to 2.184. So what you can do is, as an approximation, for a rough calculation, the denominator can be approximated to be 1 plus beta times RE, because this 1 plus beta times RE is much, much larger with respect to R pi. And since beta is also larger, then beta and 1 plus beta can also be taken to be same. So then ultimately, this one, the ultimate expression or the rough value of the voltage gain can be approximated to be minus RC upon RE. So for any competitive examination, you will find that whenever this big circuit is given to you, if you know this approximation, and then roughly you can find out what should be the possible value, the rough estimation of the voltage gain. Even for any practical purpose, if you do some calculation in your lab with a circuit like this, and whenever you're measuring the voltage gain, you can have some approximation from this particular description. And we're finding that the value of RC in this particular case was given like 2 kilo ohms, and RE was given like 1 kilo ohm. So roughly the voltage gain will be 2 upon 1, that is 2. But in fact, the practical value or actual value of the voltage gain will be somewhat less than 2, because we have neglected this R pi in the denominator. So you understand that the voltage gain will be close to 2, but it will be less than 2. And that can also be validated from our final expression of 1.938. So from this particular example, you know how to find out all the DC component, like the base current, the collector current, and the corresponding DC potential at the collector terminal, emitter terminal, or the collector to emitter drop also, you can calculate. And based on those values of collector current and base current, you can calculate the corresponding value of R0, GM, and R pi, which are essential to formulate the small signal equivalent circuit. And once you get the small signal equivalent circuit, then you can apply some KVL and KCL to find out the expression for the voltage gain. So today, with this two examples, two numerical problems, I would like to conclude my today's discussion, and that will be continued in the next tutorial on Unit 2 and Unit 3.